Right, as always, we always begin the shows by saying thank you to our guests, and it's good because I've got Chris joining me this time, which is good, so it's a double interview show because we're both big fans of not just the movie Big Trouble in Little China and other films that this man has been in, but we're a big fan of the man himself. So thank you, James Pax, for giving us some time today.
It's my great pleasure, Dave and Chris, to be on the show. Thank you for your invitation.
Oh, we've been looking forward to this for quite a while now, and I think let's begin. Of course, we'll begin because not too long ago, Chris and Adam released a show about Big Trouble in Little China, where you played Lightning in it. And first of all, we're both huge fans of the film, and I think we both agreed, didn't we, Chris, that James is a standout in it because I talk about iconic scenes in cinema. You're in some of those, James. Can you tell us, and I know you must have told this story plenty of times before, but how did it come about that you got the part of Lightning in Big Trouble in Little China?
That is definitely a story that I would like to tell 100 times more because it's a classic, I would say, from a nobody to somebody. Let's put it that way, which is what I really concentrate on, you know, telling people. I always believe in positivity. You know, I mean, maybe I'm being a little too much of, optimist. But I really feel, you know, I'm getting older now. And I kind of went away from Hollywood and been spending more time in Asia, in Hong Kong. And for the last 20 years, I'm pretty much living in China, but I still go back to LA and to UK and Europe from time to time. But after I lived in Asia, you know, for a while, then I all of a sudden begin to realize that the world is really becoming such a calamity, you know? And everything you see right now, it's about violence, da-da-da-da-da, racism, you know, Asian hates and everything, especially in the last 2 years, it's so sad for me as a human being, you know, have Chinese and half British. My dad is British. Mm-hmm. And seeing so much hatred going on in the world, you know, in America and also in Europe as well, you know. And I really feel that people need to be more unified, you know. It don't matter what color and what country mm-hmm. you are, should all unified and create a better environment for people to live in.
Yeah, definitely.
And that's what I would like to do for people. So that's why every time when I'm on the show, I like to be positive. I like to be inspiring to people. And that's why I would like to tell the story of how I got this incredible part. This was like, I think at that time I was about 23 or 25. Freshly out of college, worked 2 years at the Wall Street, at one of the stock brokerage house, because my parents in Hong Kong had their own brokerage house. So I was trained to take over my parents' business. But since I was a child, I've always been very active in music, singing, and Kung Fu. Kung Fu has always been with me, as I'm inspired by Bruce, as many other people, hundreds and millions of people. I dive into Kung Fu training, karate, taekwondo, wushu, kung fu, I did it all. And on top of that, when I was living in New York, you know, as a teenager, I watched Nureyev. You know Nureyev because you're probably the right age to know Nureyev.
Yeah.
Nureyev, Baryshnikov, back in the 80s and 90s, they were the superstar of ballet. Mm-hmm. And because and most of the people would say, oh, it's so sissy, you know, so sissy. I tell you, when I put on my first leotard and learn how to do ballet, I said, no, sorry, this is no sissy work at all. Unless you have muscle power on your leg and knowing your balance and center, you're not going to do any movement at all.
Yeah.
And because of my Kung Fu training for years, so I was immediately transfer all that good energy into learning how to do ballet. And from ballet, I went on to do jazz. And I became the first ever Asian dancer appearing in all these MTVs and TV shows. I was always the only Asian male dancer among all the other crimson, black and whites and all of that.
Yeah.
So at that point, I was very proud of myself because within 3 years, I already guest starred at the Hong Kong Royal Ballet. You know, I was able to do double tour, you know, means you're jumping up in the air and turning twice. Whoa. And come down and your feet is in place, in total balance. And that's how all these wonderful people, you know, Bruce and Nureyev really inspired me. Mm-hmm. Because to me, when I first went to see Nureyev performing Swan Lake and seeing a male dancer, you know, among 25 other lady dancers on stage, but then as soon as this man comes out, your attention goes straight to Nureyev and everybody else just fade away. Immediately, it reminds me of Bruce. Mm-hmm. Because in my opinion, there are actors and there are born stars.
Yeah.
Actors can be great actors, but you're not a born star. But people like Nureyev and Bruce, they are born to be star. Mm-hmm. They just have to sit there, or maybe they just stand there and your eyes automatically goes to them. Yeah. Because I also learned that when I was studying at the actor studio in New York, you know, the famous actor studio. Mm-hmm. And Nureyev gave me that same aura as Bruce. As you know, Bruce, when he started talking, he's so animated and you just can't take your eyes away from him. The same thing with Nureyev. And that's why it inspired me to be a dancer. So combining dance and kung fu, I got a good agent in New York. And my agent actually was the same man who promoted Zhang Long, of course. Probably few of the audience knows who Zhang Long are, because Zhang Long back in the 80s and 90s was the hottest Asian star. He's as big, maybe even bigger than Jackie Chan.
Wow.
Today. He's bigger than Jet Li, he's bigger than Jackie Chan, because back then there was nobody else. Bruce died. The next Asian actor coming up is Zhang Long. He's the one that did First Emperor. Mm-hmm. And 2 years before that was Year of the Dragon. You probably know of the movie Year of the Dragon.
Yeah, yeah.
By Michael Cimino. It's the first American Hollywood-made Chinese mafia movie. It's almost a equivalent of GAFA, the Chinese GAFA.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's how. And the movie was written by another wonderful director. I can't remember his name. But the movie was so incredibly good. And Zhang was also a very good looking Asian man from Hong Kong. He was incredible. Again, he is a born star, mm-hmm. I must say. And he was instantly become a notable upcoming actor in Hollywood. 2 years later, he did the movie Big Trouble, not Big Trouble. He did the movie The Last Emperor, directed by Bernardo Bertolucci. That movie was like $40 million production, shot in China. And the Italian director directed it, won 5 Academy Awards. 5 Academy Awards from Best Picture, Best Director, Best Costume, Best Music. Boom! Unfortunately, Zhang did not win the award for the Best Actor. But the movie drove him to, boom, the stardom. And immediately he became a superstar. And that's, and the same actor who promoted him, not the same agent, he also signed me up when he saw me sending him these press coverage of a play I did. And little tiny little play I did in Seattle Intiman Theater. This is almost like 30, 40 years ago.
Yeah.
And we had like a 60 days run, 2-character play, but it was so powerful. And that I played the lead. It was the same character that Zhang had played 10 years prior.
Ah, okay.
And so the manager, it impresses the manager so much that he said, you are going to be the next Zhang Long. You are the younger version of Zhang Long, and you have very similar quality, and I want to sign you. That's how I got into this very reputable agency in New York. They represent everybody. Kevin Kline, you know, the top stage actor in New York all belong to that agency. Yeah. And I'm just a little potato when I first went in there with only my, you know, little play, which was very popular.
Yeah.
That's how I got in. Anyway, make it short. He called me and said, James, I got this part, but they're not so sure which part they want to give you, but you need to go in and audition. And I said, okay, fine. Tell me about the part. So then they sent me a couple of pages. They say you either play this part or you probably can be one of the action actor. I said, okay, fine. So after I read these things, I said, well, one part was actually the leading part. You know, that has a lot of lines, which Dennis Dunn ended up getting it. I was very jealous, by the way, back then, okay? Which I'll tell you why later. I'm a very ambitious man because I do not want to be a loser. I always want to be a winner because I believe in myself. Because since I was a kid, I said, whatever I put my mind into it, I will make it happen.
Yeah.
If I tell myself I can do it, I will make it happen. And don't matter who's going to tell me, no, James, you can't do it. I said, no, I'm going to make it happen because I'm going to show you what I can do. That's always my attitude towards my work and towards my career. Mm-hmm. So anyway, I prepare myself for like 2 weeks with my partner, who is a wushu expert. And he taught me a lot of wushu moves. I was taking lessons from him. So we prepared a whole 10-minute action from fists into weapons. 10 minutes. So we brought it in. John Carpenter was there, the producer, and also the casting director. And Slay My Name, immediately we go into this 10-minute nonstop action. By the end of the action, John stood up and said, that was incredible. That was the best audition I've seen so far. You know, so I was very happy. So I went home, I called up my agent. I said, I think I did a pretty good job, but I don't know what kind of part they're going to give me. So then almost like a week later, they say, they want to give you the part. I said, oh, okay. Is it going to be the leading part? Because that was a part I actually read. You know, lightning has no lines. So I did the action and then I read for the leading part, which was Dennis Dunn's part.
Yeah.
When he said, you got the part, I said, oh, yeah, good. I'm getting the leading part. He said, no, you're not getting that part. You're playing the lightning. I said, lightning, I remember there has no lines. You know, just shooting a lightning in the hands. I said, whoa. He said, don't worry, James. This is going to be the one and only Hollywood-made kung fu movie after Bruce Lee, who had died prior to you probably 10 years ago. This is going to be a chance for you. You just make the best out of it, and something might just happen from there. Because back then I was living in New York. Strangely enough, on the same week, I went for another audition, which was General Hospital. You probably know.
Yeah.
Very big soap opera, you know.
Yeah.
Was sold all over the world. General Hospital has been on TV for 10 years. They never had an Asian part. They said, and then they designed a new Asian part, and I went out for it. Same week, we got the offer from General Hospital. And they said, they want to offer you a long-term contract. They need you to sign a 2-year contract with a couple of thousand US dollars per year kind of a thing. And you're going to be on many, many episodes because you're going to be the new Asian, you know, lead.
Yeah.
So after I got both offer, we discussed and my agent was advising me, yes, General Hospital is good, but you need to move on into the big screen. This is a chance. You should take it. Fine. I took his advice, went straight to LA, got fitted. Boom. I got the part. That's basically how I got the part. Yeah.
Wow. Well, those choices you've got to make sometimes, isn't there? You know, you've got those decisions and you can go that way or that way. And
that's right.
Yeah. What was it like on the set then, once you got actually onto the set and you got your scenes? I mean, because the sets were incredible as well.
It's you know, back then there was no such a thing as CGI. Mm. Everything was real. I recall we were on like 6 studios, means, you know, how big these studios are. Each studio is like a football field. Mm-hmm. And we are on 6 studios. Everything is hand built the sets, the tunnel, the underwater, everything is inside the studio. That's how incredible it is. You know, and one of the most incredible scenes was the den where they have all the Buddhas, like 30 Buddhas, you know, from left and right. In the end, the Buddhas will just tumble one from the other. Everything was handmade or handcrafted, and everything is so real that, you know, me as an actor, I felt feel like a dwarf, you know, because I'm just one of the actor. Mm-hmm. And comparing myself to the immaculate work that these carpenters has to put into it, I feel I'm a nobody, you know, comparing to how much time they already put in just to put these beautiful sets on so the actors can walk in there and say their great line. And probably at the end of the day, the glory is all going to go to the actor and the director, you know, and these craftsmen, they only get their little name at the very end. If you wanted to really, you really, if not, you don't get it. So but I, as an actor, I truly appreciate all that wonderful work that was put in there so that we can enjoy, you know, to be part of it, really. It's such a big production. Yeah. It made a nobody realize that what it's like to be in a major Hollywood production.
Yeah, definitely.
Honestly, when I was 17 or 18, you know, I was living in America. My parents were living in Hong Kong. And I always thought about being an actor. So I go home for summer vacation and my mother's friend took me to the studio and had me audition, kind of audition for one of the big name director. And at the time they were already interested in me, but then I see that, you know, everything is so, you know, the sets are not so real. The only good thing about Hong Kong back then was that every Kung Fu man is so great. But these flimsy looking sets, you touch it, it's going to fall, that kind of thing. So then from knowing that in Hong Kong, and also just to let you know, till today, in Hong Kong, you don't get a big trailer, a mule truck. In Hollywood, you get a big truck with meals, everything free, roast beef, you know, three kinds of roast beef, big salad, and then tea and coffee anytime you want, and then donuts, everything for free from day till night. And I recall a lot of extras. They said, "Would you rather be an extra than sitting at home doing nothing?" Because we get all our meals for free. And same for me. I'd rather be working than not working because all the meals are so wonderful. You can really get fat on it. That's the thing.
Yeah, that's not going to help with your martial arts training if you eat too much of that. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Because Chris,
that's how incredible Hollywood production is.
Yeah,
and it really make you feel that you as an actor you're proud to be in such a big production.
Yeah.
Honestly, back then we did not think. Nobody think this is going to be a huge hit. Except John Carpenter. I think John has such an expectation for it. Mm-hmm. But and yet when the movie was released, as you know, back then, this is almost 35 years ago, but I remember very, very clearly in the same week across the theaters, another movie was on, which was called Ghostbuster. Mm-hmm. It was on in the same week. And 20th Century Fox, I hear that the marketing man director kind of like cramps on their hands. They said, "Oh my God, you know, Ghostbuster had three big superstars."
Yeah.
You know, they were from the Saturday Night Fever, remember? And look at our movie. You know, John Carpenter was the biggest thing. And of course, Kurt Russell, you know, but there's only one Kurt Russell. The other side had three superstars. So they said, "We are not going to beat them. And this is Chinese subject matter, you know. We're not going to beat them, so let's not even put any money into the promotion." That's what happened.
Mm.
They did not put money into the promotion, which they were supposed to.
Yeah.
And that's why it did not do so well in the box office, honestly. And it was a big disappointment for John Carpenter, and I think he was totally disappointed. But whereas for us, you know, we were proud to be in it. We went to the theater to see it. We said, "Oh, wow, what a great movie, and it's so funny." you know, even though the box office didn't do too well and we heard about the story, but I said, hey, you know, at least while you're in it, being Asians, let me tell you, I mean, again, going back to this thing is equal, you know, for all races, which is what I truly believe in. Hmm. Back then in the 80s, the strata is white, black, Latino, Asians. So I'm part of the Asians. I'm the very in the very bottom of this pyramid. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm competing not with white, black, or Latinos. I'm competing with another 50 Asian actors. Mm. Every time I go for a part, I'm competing with another 25 people I see all the time.
Yeah.
And that's how sad it is.
Yeah.
You know, it's that's just the way the business is. So I cannot complain.
Yeah.
You know, I cannot complain and I just take it as it comes. So for an Asian actor to get a part, whether it's a small part or a big part we call it a guest star in the TV series, which I did many, it's already an honor and people get excited, which I was very lucky after I landed and did The Big Trouble. I got a lot of parts. Mm-hmm. It's like, whatever part I go for, 90% I get them.
Yeah.
Which makes me feel a little sorry because all the other actors, because there are so few parts. So I'm the one getting all the parts. And that's one of the reasons I left Hollywood. You know why? Because I feel that if I keep getting the part, then what happened to the other guys? You know, also at a point after I did the series, you know, after Big Trouble, I did a big series called Nasty Boys. I know it's out in UK like a movie, you know, two episodes per movie kind of a thing, because each episode is only 45 minutes. So two episodes together, then make it into a DVD and sell it as a TV movie. And that's what I understand. That's what they did. So 13 episodes, they probably had 6 or 7 DVD, which was very popular. It's a wonderful TV series. Dick Wolf produced it. Me and Benjamin Brad and Dennis Franz and a couple of other American actor were all in it. Very successful, but unfortunately, due to some delay of scheduling, after 13 episodes, it got canceled. But right after that, I said, I'm already at the top of my career. The only person on top of me is Jung Long. But I'm not going to chase after him. He already had the market. I need to have my own market. And then offers start coming in from Hong Kong. They said, you know, you're such a wonderful actor. You can act and your kung fu is good. Why don't you come to Hong Kong and do our movies? So then it lured me back to Hong Kong, which is my hometown. My parents live there. So I went and started doing Hong Kong movies. And the first movie I did was with Michelle Yeoh. You know Michelle Yeoh. Superstar today. You know, she did the one of the Bond movie with Brosnan, right?
Tomorrow Never Dies, yeah.
Yes. That's how she got started. And she was very kind to me. She knew I was a newcomer, you know, and we both, you know, speak English. So she recommended me to the director, and immediately that director took me in. And I play kind of her love interest in this movie called Heroic Trio. It was a huge success. Three leading ladies, they were all playing warriors, and I was the man that was trying to save the life of Michelle Yeoh kind of thing. I play a scientist kind of. And that's how I got into the Hong Kong scene from Hollywood, basically. Let me stop here so that you can ask the next question, because I just keep ranting on and off.
I know it's awesome, and I've been dying to jump in at some point, but I just want to let you carry on talking because it's brilliant, and I'm kind of geeking out a little bit now. I've even worn my I don't know if you can see it very well, my Big Trouble in Little China t-shirt just because. A couple of things first. This is going to be, you're going to not be able to walk out of your room in a minute because you're going to have a big head, but this is just 5 minutes James Pax appreciation time. Just a couple of things that you've just picked up on what you've just mentioned is, I love your positive energy. I love the fact that, you know, you've got such a great attitude towards life. And like you said, you want to spread that positivity. I think that's amazing. And also the fact that you're so willing to talk about Big Trouble in Little China at length, you know, because sometimes you'll you'll read stories or you'll hear about actors that are maybe famous for certain roles and they don't necessarily want to talk about it in a lot of detail because they've told the stories 100 times. And I just think it's great that you want to share your stories of being on that movie because it is such an important movie for a lot of people. And what Adam and I found when we were revisiting it, I mean, we spoke for like 2.5-3 hours about the movie, and the movie's like an hour and a half, you know what I mean? So we talked at great length, and you know, it's a movie that we love and a lot of people love. And your character in particular, you've got the Three Storms, and you know, I think although you haven't got any lines in the movie, I think it's fair to say that you are one of the most influential out of the Three Storms in terms of just the one that leaves the mark on people because of your what you do, the lightning and everything. Just there's something about your character that draws people to look at you and you on the screen. And we had a conversation about, well, which was your favorite storm, you know, when you were a kid? And it was lightning, because you were just cool. Do you know what I mean? Although there's no dialogue as such, I think that almost adds a sort of element of mystique to your character as well. So I just wanted to say thank you for that. The one question I want to ask you is, although Big Trouble in Little China wasn't necessarily a box office smash that it deserved to be at the time, in my opinion, what makes you think that people love it even now, over 30 odd years after its original release? What kind of makes you think that people still love it? My own opinion is that it's got everything in it. It's got martial arts, it's got comedy, it's got action, it's got some drama and some tension, it's got monsters, you know, it kind of packs in a lot. And one of the things that we discussed was that there was nothing in a Western audience like it at the time. You know, I watched Jackie Chan movies growing up, you know, like Police Story and Armor of God and, you know, Sammo Hung and Yuen Biu and films like that they were in, Bruce Lee, of course. But that it was never really a Western thing. But this brings in, like you said, a massive production, a huge kind of emphasis on Eastern mythology and, you know, an Eastern culture. And it's kind of like that East meets West. And reading some of the notes on IMDb, you know, it was originally intended to be a Western, from what I understand. And then John Carpenter brought his own spin into it with the Eastern stuff. And, you know, I can't remember anything like it, you know. And it's nowadays, you know, martial arts and Eastern philosophy and everything is huge, you know, in cinema, particularly in Western cinema. Like Shang-Chi was massive last year. But at the time, in 1986, there was nothing like it. So, but going back to my original question, like I said, what makes it endure? Why do you think people still love this movie?
Yes, I often think about it myself. But like you already mentioned, all these factors in terms of it is mythology, Chinese mythology, underground world, monsters, beautiful ladies with green eyes, these weird characters played by what's his name, the old chap, you know, and then the three incredible storms that just, you know, drops down from the ceiling, you know, each have their own incredible power. And the costumes are just one of the kind.
Yeah.
I don't think it won any award, but I really truly think that year this movie should have won for the best costume for sure, because it was so original. And we wear it, we feel like we are the warrior, that kind of things, you know, and the way the weapons are designed and even my little spinning blade. Yeah. Today I have it custom made. And I can sell it to my fans because everybody want that blade and they all wonder how to get it. And I already got it made in China here. But all of those factors, I think, is what makes it special. But more than that, I recall many years ago, there's a movie called Raiders of the Lost Ark. I think Steven Spielberg shot it. To me, this is like the Chinese version of Raiders of Lost Ark. You know, that is more, I believe it was Egyptian or something like that, but this one is strictly, is very Chinese underground, you know, and the time zone is today, and yet it goes back hundreds of years ago, you know, in reference to that. And yet it was a modern day in San Francisco underground, you know, and then with a bus, you know, just all these tiny little elements make that movie is so special, and that you can either identify with it and say, wow, that is so brilliant, you know, these little details, which also inspire me when I write my own movie like Shaolin Temple. I try to be detailed about each character, mm-hmm. and try to find something that is going to make this character stand out by itself, just like lightning, just like thunder, just like Rain or the two lady character and the nemesis, you know, and Jack Burton, all those characters are very distinctly individualized. Mm. And I think all of that elements combined together make this such a great movie, you know, forever, basically.
Just talking about the costumes, I mean, in particular yours as well, because I think it's like you've got this metallic kind of armor, and you use that to effect by when you're creating all the lightning. Like you said, it makes it stand out even more because how the lightning reflects and moves, you know, in regard to your costume. But I think, you know, one of the things that we haven't really talked about is Kurt Russell. And looking back at it, although he's the lead actor and, you know, he's on the posters and everything, he's really not the hero of the piece, is it? He's not that, you know, because he's a bit of an idiot, you know, he's cocky, he's arrogant, but, and really the main hero is Dennis Dunn's character, because he can, you know, so, and like you said, like the Asian characters. So that was interesting. And I think that's, again, possibly what contributed to the marketing people being a bit confused with, well, Kurt Russell's supposed to be the hero, but actually, he messes up a lot of the time, or he doesn't do everything that he's supposed to do. And Dennis Dunn's character saves the day, you know. So that's, again, going back to what you were saying about, you know, you were saying that Asian sort of actors and characters are at the bottom of the food chain, so to speak. But that was one of the good things about the movies that elevated those kind of, you know, Asian actors to the top, you know, and maybe people weren't ready for that at the time. I'm not sure, but you know, that was just an observation. But I do, thank you so much for telling these stories about Big Trouble, because it's, you know, awesome. This is funny how life takes these odd twists, isn't it? Last year I was talking about a movie that I love, and now I'm talking to one of my favorite actors, you know, and people in the film. And you can't, just again, a bit of a James Pax appreciation, is there's the really influential in terms of, I suppose, video game culture and that how the movie was. So your character in particular, I'm not sure if you like video games or if you know of them, but Raiden from Mortal Kombat, yes. You know, arguably based on your character in the movie.
Yes.
And also Lo Pan is, you can argue, is Shang Tsung from the movie, who's like the, you know, the one that does all the magic and the bad guy and everything. So just, it's a really influential movie, so I just wanted to say thank you again for doing such a great job, you know.
It's my pleasure. I feel that I'm just one of the tool of John Carpenter. I'm so blessed to be chosen for that part and to be part of this legacy, I would say, I think. And I really feel that if 20th Century Fox boss put the money in it, it probably would have done much better, of course.
Yeah.
But still, after 20 years, 30 years later, it still became a cult film. I had many fans came to me, you know, on my fan club and said, oh, James, you know what? I grew up with your movie, you know, and I really respect you. I said, well, you know, I'm so blessed that you said that to me, because I'm blessed to be playing a part that becomes so influential to so many of you, mm-hmm. kept your company, give you encouragement in life, and give you hope, you know, in whatever you wanted to do. And I'm blessed to be part of it. Really, still today, I feel blessed. Even, I have to tell you,
it's good.
It is not easy. Mm. I'm going to tell you something, hopefully 20 years later or maybe 10 years later when I'm back in Hollywood doing all these big movies, and everybody's going to say, James, how did you make it? Maybe 10 years later, I will be able to tell the entire world saying that. No, it is not my agent. No, it is not the producer of so-and-so studio. It is my fan. Mm-hmm. They are the one that helped me.
No, that,
gave me the encouragement.
That's good. That's good to hear, James, and that you're as appreciative of your fan base as you know your fans worldwide are as appreciative of you too, which is it's really nice to hear that. And I'd love to know as well what the experience was like for you to see Big Trouble on the big screen for the first time, not only just to see yourself again on the big screen, but to see the finished, because you're on set, and obviously it's a different experience to what you see on the screen. What was it like for you that first time?
It just makes everything so much bigger, because the screen is so huge. When you're acting in it, you feel small. But when you see yourself or see other actors in the big movie, you say, wow, this is incredible. That's what Hollywood making, movie making is like. Mm. Everything is magnified 50 times more. And I was just totally enjoying watching it. You know, so many characters in and out, chasing each other. It was just a fun movie. Like I said, to me, it's a Chinese version of, Raiders of Lost Ark. Mm. So it was very dynamic when I first saw it. Even today, when I see it again, footage here and there, I say, my God, 20 years ago without CGI, they were able to do that. The only thing was my lightning was all drawn in.
Yeah.
Everything was drawn in. It was not CGI, but it was hand-drawn in. And even if you look at it today, it looks so real that you wonder how can an artist do it with hands, mm-hmm. and that these lightnings had a darker color or lighter color, and then the color changes so naturally, look like real lightning. And that's where all the artwork department comes in.
It amazing really is. It really is, and you're absolutely right. The thing is about it is that, there was a lot of practical effects, although the film is, like I said, over 30 years old, it feels kind of timeless. It hasn't aged particularly, I don't think, at all. It still feels fresh and relevant. And, and I think that's all credit, like you said, to the people that helped to make the film. One last question for me, Bess, because I know you've got loads of other things you want to talk about as well, but there's been talk about a remake of Big Trouble in Little China for so many years now. Different actors are attached to it. Because I also want to ask you about Dennis Franz as well, because I love Dennis Franz. Big fan of his from NYPD Blue, but I'll get onto that in a second. But what are your thoughts on that? Is it something that you welcome? Do you think that the original should just stay as it is? Or what are your thoughts on a remake?
Well, first of all, I think the movie came out a little too early. If the movie comes out today, or even 5 years before, I think the movie would have made $200 million to $300 million. Because after all, you mentioned about Shang-Chi. I agree. Shang-Chi made $450 million because I did a lot of research on it. Without even the Chinese market, was not owned in Chinese market, it did $450. And that already surpassed Black Widow and all of that. I think it was ranking number 5 or number 6 of last year's box office. So if The Big Trouble comes out today, I think it would have done the same number, with huge success. So it is definitely a movie came out a little earlier than it should. But Rock Johnson bought the rights because I did research. He's going to make it. I think it's courageous for him to want to make this movie. And I think he would do it right, to do a continuation of the story. And indeed, Dennis did a wonderful job in the part, although I do want to play the part myself. And I have to say why, because I've been asked before. you know, only when I got on the set, I realized that why they picked Dennis Dunn and not picked me. It probably wasn't because of my acting, it's because of my height, because I'm much taller, you know. Dennis is a cute little guy. And in comparison to Kurt Russell, that is a better combo than me standing next to Kurt Russell, because him and I stand together and it just look kind of odd. Mm. Instead, Dennis standing next to him, it looked right. So I celebrate Dennis for playing the part, and he certainly was very funny. He was very right for the part. But definitely, I'm on my way back to Hollywood in February. I certainly would like to meet up with the, it's belonged to Disney now, no longer the 20th Century Fox.
Yeah.
I certainly would like to meet up with the executive of the 20th Century Fox. I said, is tell them that you should do it, this movie right, and you need James to be the advisor, because I can claim myself to be a Chinese expert now, since I lived in China for 20 years. I'm willing to offer my knowledge and my service to make all these Chinese mysteries, you know, interesting for the audience. And if you want me to play a part, I'd love to play it. I really see that this should become a legacy. And I even think about right now that I wanted to do a TV series, just like Cobra Kai of the Karate Kid.
Yeah,
that'd be awesome. I think it would be really interesting to take that Big Trouble and make it into a TV series. I already have some ideas on it, so hopefully something might happen out of that.
You never know.
But definitely is a great idea.
Yeah, that'd be amazing.
Yeah, fingers crossed for that, definitely. And if it does get the remake, you should at the very least get a cameo part in it, at the very least, you know. So yeah, let's keep our fingers crossed for that. And we could sit here for hours and hours and just talk about Big Trouble, but there's a lot more to your career than Big Trouble in Little China, of course, and you're still very busy and active today. Please let me and Chris know, and everybody listening and watching the YouTube version as well, the things that what have you got going on now? You've got so much planned and recently done. Let's get everybody up to date with what's happening with James Pax these days.
All righty. As I was saying, that I spent the last 20 years in Asia to study about my roots. The other half of my roots are Chinese. So I spent a lot of time understanding about Chinese culture and history and so on and so forth. Just so you know, 2006, I starred in a TV movie called The First Emperor. And it was actually financed by Channel 4 UK and also Discovery USA. It was a very successful little TV movie. It was done in docudrama style, means it is a documentary, but 70% of it, it's all dramatized, means actual actors acting out the parts. And I recall when it first went on the Channel 4 UK, the rating went up to 18% at one stage.
Wow.
So
that's good.
Amazing.
Yeah, that's
and
good.
And again, in Channel 4 UK, Discovery USA, they also told me that they got more sponsors than they ever have in the program. And it was a very successful little film, and it was sold to every single TV channel around the globe. That's how successful it is.
Wow, that's really good.
Again, that was Chinese, you know, the first emperor comparing to the last emperor. Mm. That was 20 years prior to that, you know, done by Bernardo Bellucci. Mm-hmm. So I was very proud to be in that production. And in the last 20 years, I've written 3 scripts. And the one that I'm pursuing right now, it's called Shaolin Warriors 7. And I took the name out of Seven Samurai, if you recall that movie in the 60s in black and white by the famous Japanese director. And I think it won best foreign film back then. So I took that concept, injected into Shaolin Temple. Shaolin Temple is a subject matter that amazes audience around the globe. And because of my study of Wushu, and I always got very amused by the elements inside the Shaolin Temple. And while I was in China, I had my own Shaolin Temple exhibition group, means Kung Fu group, traveling in Asia and also in UK. We did many shows and appeared on many TV shows. So I know a lot about Shaolin action.
Yeah.
And this was actually just about a year and a half ago. This was before Shang-Chi was aired. And I started writing the script without knowing that whether it's going to be successful or not, but I just believe that this is a subject matter that's going to attract a lot of attention. But after I'd written it, then all of a sudden Shang-Chi released and made $450 million. I said, my God, it was the right timing for me.
Yeah.
You know, and yet one of my fans said, oh, James, you know, I know that you're trying to make this, but Shang-Chi already came out. What do you think? Is it going to be bad for you? I said, no, of course not. This is bad. This is good. This is only a foreplay of Shaolin. They are the one that paved the road for me already. Because if audience know Shang-Chi can make 100 million, 50, and I probably can make 600 million to a billion, right? If Star Wars can do a billion, why do you think Shaolin cannot do, you know, the same number? Who knows, right? Besides, China market is another 300 million.
Yeah, yeah.
All of that. So, but let me tell you a little bit more about this. It's an IP I created. The plans we have expanded from a movie into a TV pilot, into a game, computer game, and a comic book. And I already took myself into producing a comic book as we speak right now. We have about 5 pages ready to go. Mm-hmm. And on top of that, I just joined up with a island company who is also one of my fans, Richard. He was very kind and he loved the idea. So he offered the knowledge of the computer game, and he is leading the team to create a model type so that we can have a discussion with a major publication company and join up together, hopefully to make this a big computer game, just like Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
So the project is very exciting. We are hoping to have something launched by July for the computer game. And in between that, the comic book is going to come out. And out of these 7 characters, 7 warriors. There are 4 Chinese. One of them is Tiger, which is the leading character. It's the year of the Tiger. So I launch it with Tiger.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm playing the Tiger. Okay. And Tiger Fist is one of the most famous Shaolin Kung Fu, because Shaolin Kung Fu has so many different variations. But they call it the animal fist, which actually created by the Shaolin Temple. Mm-hmm. Okay. And that's why Disney took it and made it into Panda Kung Fu.
Yeah.
Remember all those animals?
Yeah. You know,
it actually came out of the Shaolin Kung Fu, by the way. And it's written on the big, it was all carved on the wall of Shaolin Temple. So actually Shaolin Temple owns the right. And I think Disney should pay some tribute to that, which they never did, which I'm not very happy of.
Yeah.
But anyway, to make the story short, I'm paying tribute to Shaolin Temple. And my character is Tiger. And then we also created 2 characters for the international actor to join in. One is TikTok, like tic-tac-toe. But her real name is Samantha. We call her Sam. She is half white and half black. A young girl, 17, 18 years old, just getting ready to get into college. She's a Taekwondo specialist. And she's going to learn how to do the nunchuk. I'm going to teach her myself because I'm a nunchuk expert. and that's her character. And then we have a male Caucasian character by the name of Ricardo. Ricardo. And he's a vigilante. He's a chef in a diner, that kind of character. But he got recruited into joining the Shaolin Warriors. So basically, that's the combination of all these characters. But to go back to the Big Trouble in Little China Lightning, inspired by the Lightning character I played, I have injected Lightning into one of the characters, which is the fugitive He. It's Chinese pronunciation, and I don't even know how to write it, but I just write it as H-E, but it's actually pronounced He. He's a fugitive. He's being hunted, basically. And he is going to have that look, a similar look as Lightning with a hat, you know, and the armor and all of that. And he does incredible kung fu. That's the link between Big Trouble and the Shaolin Warrior 7.
I love that.
So basically, the way I design these characters is that, yes, they are superheroes, but they are humans. So unlike Marvels and all those characters, they can fly, they have superpower. These youngsters have no superpower. Mm. They only have flesh and blood and their muscles and their great kung fu, Shaolin kung fu skill. So the way they're going to play the game is wherever, in whatever time zone, because they're going to be traveling on Vortex, they're going to save the world from peril, whether it's zombies attack or terrorism or atom bomb attack or whatever, these seven youngsters are going to save the world from peril. And that's basically the scope of the whole movie. So there are many possibilities. That's why I say this thing could go as a TV series as well, because you can imagine it's a vortex. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, to fight against whatever the nemesis are. And that's what makes it so interesting, basically. And that's why Richard said, oh, wow, this is incredible. We should make it into a computer game. On top of that, I'm already talking to a pretty big company in UK, Monopoly, actually. You probably heard of them.
Yeah,
they're a Comic-Con company.
Yeah, we do.
They're very
we
big
deal.
In Ireland, I understand.
Yeah, they're really good. We cover everything Monopoly do, which is very exciting, because I know that because we cover everything that they do, and if you're going to come across to the UK, James, yeah.
There you go. Well, you know, Mr. Boss at the Monopoly, who is already talking to me since last year, he said, oh, I want to bring the whole team, you know, out to Scotland and Ireland to do the Big Trouble in Little China. But then, you know, last year was COVID, and Lo Pan was not ready to do it. You know, he's getting a little old. So I said, okay, fine, whenever you're ready, let me know, and we're ready to do it. And this year he came back and said, now I'm ready to do it. But I said, wait, besides the Lightning, I will do it for you. I would like to have Shaolin Warrior 7 join up with the Lightning character. It means when I go on the Comic-Con tour in UK, it will be Lightning plus the Shaolin Warrior 7. Mm-hmm. So how am I going to do it? I'm going to do it the one and only Shaolin Warriors cosplay tour. Means I have at least 3 to 4 of the characters dressed in the costume, mm-hmm. in the Shaolin costumes, boys and girls, including myself. And we're going to go to the Comic-Con and meet the old and the new fans. And all the fans can come up and ask for autographs, photo ops, and on top of that, I'm going to do Q&A. To tell people about this IP, because this is the best way to tell people.
Yeah.
And let's show a couple of frames from the video game so they know that it's coming. And then a couple of pictures from the comic book, because these are all coming. And the actors are going to pose, and one or two, these actors, one of them is Sang Gao. I'm giving him a big plug, because later I'm going to tell you who Sang Gao is. Mm-hmm. He's going to play one of the Warriors. He's going to do on-site demonstration of the best Shaolin Kung Fu you ever seen since Jet Li. came back.
I'm ready for this already. I don't know about you, Chris.
Sounds really exciting, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does. It does.
I love the fact that it covers so many different aspects. So you've got the movie, you've got potentially TV show, comics and video games. Because, I mean, they're all huge, aren't they? I mean, video games in particular are massive. So if you can link all of them together, it sounds like you're really busy. You've got so much going on.
Yeah. How are you doing, James, juggling all of, you know, all of this at once?
Well, I must say that, you know, I'm a man who likes to juggle several balls at the same time, because I'm always, like I said, you know, I think it's hard today for you to find an actor who not just act, can sing, can do kung fu, and also be a ballet and jazz dancer. I think I'm the only one around, I must say.
That's a good skill set,
And I've been doing that, you know, since I was young, because I always have various interests, although I studied at NYU was marketing and finance, but I always had, my heart is always in art, you know. So anything that moves and anything related to music, I'm very keen on it. And then, of course, these fans are so kind to contribute ideas and teach me about the business of the computer games and things like that. And that's how I got into it. That's why I say I'm blessed, because I have these wonderful fans who are supportive and believe in my project. And now they are all my partner, and we're going to make this IP big, and you are included to help me to promote this IP.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, we'll do everything that we can to help promote James. Of course we will. Yeah, it'd be our pleasure. Definitely.
Thank you. And I hope the Monopoly is going to sign a contract soon, because I'm looking at doing a 4-5 city tour in UK for this cosplay show, basically.
That sounds so good. We'll have to. Yeah, Chris, we'll have to get together and meet up with James at one of these shows, I think.
Absolutely.
I'd love to see you there. You both have to come, all right? And then the drinks and the dinner is on me, all right? We're all going to have a great time.
Oh, that's awesome.
And one great thing, you got to hear this. This is one of a kind. Like I said, I always do something that nobody's ever done before. Besides the cosplay show, during the daytime, I'm looking to do a DJ party at night. It could be an individual event, or it could be a rap party of the Comic-Con. So that's how I offered it. Means myself, I'm a DJ, but I have other DJs on my team. So all my actors are going to be dressed up in costumes. And then we're going to have this huge DJ party, and all the fans can come and dance all night long and party with us.
It'll be like,
what do you think of that?
It'll be like being in the middle of the movie, won't it, Chris? With, you
know,
people dressed up and all the music going and the lights and everything. It will be like being in the movie itself.
That's right. Even though the movie hasn't even come out yet.
Exactly.
We're going to get a feel of what Shaolin Warriors are about, you know, with the music and everything. So I think it's going to be totally madly fun.
Oh, yeah. Like you said, it's so much for you to keep all these balls in the air and keep the projects on track going forward. And like you said, with things like the Comic-Con and all of that, and fitting that into your schedule as well, which is good. It's a good thing that you've got so much ahead of you this year and beyond as well.
With all the hard work and the hard study, you know, for the last 20 years, it's time for me to bring myself back to Hollywood and tell Hollywood that, guys, there's a better way of making action movies. And give me a little space. Let me slide myself in there, and I'm going to show you what a kung fu movie should be made by an expert kung fu man, which is James Pax. Right now in the market, I'm the only man, not being bragging myself, I'm the only man who can write script, can act, create characters, and can do all the choreography of the action in kung fu. I'm the only man in the world right now. And that's what I wanted to prove to them, that give me the job, I will do it for you. You give me $35 million, I'm ready to make you $450 million to $1 billion in one shot, and another six coming after, just like you know, the race car movie, what's it called,
the Fast and the Furious
and something.
See,
that's basically my plan.
This is where, Chris, you should jump in and tell James about your martial arts, you see. You could... You should tell James about that and your professional fights, you see.
I wouldn't even dream to embarrass myself. Like I said, I'm 45, so I was introduced to martial arts about 6 years ago, and a bit of boxing and Thai boxing, Muay Thai, that kind of thing. But I've always been fascinated with martial arts, and it's not just the skill, it's the dedication. I think, like you said it earlier on, it's the hard work and it's the training. And this is what people don't always see. They see the end product, but they don't see all of the work. That's like kind of a small percentage of it. It's actually all of the stuff that you don't see that's goes behind scenes. How often did you train growing up? Was it every day? How many hours? Because you see, I've seen documentaries about, like I mentioned them earlier on, Sammo Hung, Yumbu, and Jackie Chan, and they went to the Peking Opera School and how grueling that was for them. So was it a similar situation for you growing up? You know, were you pushed to your limits? How was that?
I have to say, I went through a different kind of grueling training. Jackie Chan, Yuen Biu, and all these people that you can even pronounce Yuen Biu name right, which proves to me already that you are a Kung Fu expert. Because not many people know Yuen Biu. People mostly know Jackie Chan and Sammo Hung. But honestly, among all those, they are all brothers because they all came out of the Peking Opera in the same troupe. Yuen Biu is known to have the best Kung Fu ability, you know, but he kind of fade away along the way. But Yuen Biu is definitely someone I totally respect. But they have a different background and different growing up. You know, I grew up in America, studying in a petty school in New Jersey. And after the school, 3 p.m., that's when I go train and do my Kung Fu and my weightlifting. You know, I used to be really buff, like Bruce Lee, that kind of thing. But I do respect, you know, the Jackie Chan and that troupe, what they had gone through, and then they had the chance to get into the movie and to become what they are today. You know, it's definitely a continuation of the Chinese Kung Fu legacy, which led by Bruce, then to Jackie Chan, to Jet Li, da-da-da-da-da-da. And then, of course, all these wonderful American actors, such as Michael J. White, and many others, you know, whom I respect. Like I said, I'm colorblind. Mm-hmm. And I would like to invite them to come on my show and to do my Shaolin Warriors. But let me go back to my training, you know. During my high school year, I had various interests besides of keeping my grades. After 3 p.m. is when I train. First is the weight. Second is my Kung Fu, my Taekwondo, and third is fencing. I even learned of Western fencing. Fourth is horseback riding. You know, I was competing on jumping the gates and all of that. So I have very various interests in it. And from time to time, I'm also a cross-country jogging on the jogging team for like 3 miles course. So I had a lot of energy, you know, back then. Useless. It's the endless energy I had. That's why I was able to do everything all at the same time and still able to keep my grades okay. And definitely was grueling. It was nothing less than what Jackie Chan had put out for sure. And that's why I was able to audition for Big Trouble in Little China. And I carry on that training until like when I was in the 40s. And because, you know, I used to train, I would have to say 6.5 days a week. Means on Sunday, I'm still training, but I give myself half a day of rest so that Monday morning, 6 a.m., I'm ready to get up and run and do my kicks and everything. Mm-hmm. Just so you know, again, was told by all these people. When I was living in New York, I go out and train. I take my shirt off because I love to take my shirt off, just like Bruce Lee does. You know, I'm no Bruce Lee, but like I said, I imagine myself like Bruce Lee, which I'm sure many of you do that too when you're a kid.
Oh, yeah.
You know, Bruce is such a hero to everybody. And he is a hero to me till the day, I must say. Because nothing would have happened without Bruce. And this is a statement I want to make. Nothing had happened to the Chinese Kung Fu without Bruce, period.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So while I was doing all that kicking, and whatever Bruce does, I do 80% of it, I must say. And that's how I learned to kick and punch and all of that. And when the crowd gathers around me, they say, hey, are you related to Bruce? Da, da, da. I say, well, no, I'm not. You know, he passed away, but I am an admirer of us. Oh, you look so much like Bruce, the way you build, the way you move and all of that. I've been told since I was like 16 or 17 years old, in the park, on the bus, and da, 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 da. And even when I was, like I was telling you, that I was living in New York and I was taking up ballet already. And then one of the General Hospital actor, I can't remember his name now, but he was very kind. He saw me in the dance studio. And then he said, oh, James, your Kung Fu is so good. You know, can you teach me Kung Fu? And from then on, I become a Kung Fu teacher. I was his private tutor, and he was in the General Hospital. He was making a lot of money, you know. But I'm his Kung Fu teacher. So besides training myself, I was already a Kung Fu teacher, which make me very proud because I feel that I might have accomplished something, you know, from just being an enthusiast, I'm finally become a teacher. And that's how my progression is, you know. And I did not stop training until probably 10 something years ago, because through the years, I have so many injuries on my knee, especially my left knee. I can hardly jump anymore, but I can still throw in the kicks and all of that.
Yeah.
And that's why for the last 20 years, I devote myself not so much into training, but into the training of my mind. I self-taught myself how to write script, which I started 20 years ago. And only by friendly advice, she would read it and she'd say, okay, this is what you should do, and da-da-da-da-da. And I self-taught myself by trial and error. After 20 years later, I can say, yes, I'm a scriptwriter. Yes, people read my script, they say, wow, this is incredible. You should get it made. And that's a progression of my life. Kung Fu gave me everything. Mm-hmm. Gave me the spirit to lead on and chase after my dream, just like many other people. And until today, I'm still chasing after my dream, because now my dream is not being an actor. Now my dream is to have all colors of humans join together, believing in a project, and everybody make it happen. And hopefully it's going to be Shaolin Warrior 7, and it's going to be another IP that the fans are going to treasure, and the studios are going to tell James that, James, you did a great job, carry on. Yes. That's what I want to hear.
Like you said about martial arts, it's not just about the physical, it's about the mental and the spiritual, isn't it? And although as none of us are getting any younger, but you've got that opportunity to pass on your knowledge and experience to other people who you can help to make and bring into this business to make them big stars. And you've mentioned one earlier on. Do you want to talk about that person?
Yes. Since I was young, I was always very willing to help others. While I was in Hollywood, I was already making, doing very well, you know. After Big Trouble, a lot of offers came to me, and then I went on to do Nasty Boy, which I just mentioned. One of the young actors whom I consider him as my younger brother was Mark Dacascos. You probably know him.
Yeah.
From many movies.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I won't mention. At the time, he was a stuntman working at the Universal Studio. As a stuntman falling off the bridge, you know, diving into the water, which is a great show. And when I was doing my first episode, I thought about Mark, because every Sunday we go to Chinatown and we share lunch together and talk about this and that. And again, we get together twice a week. He teach me how to do tumbling. because I know nothing about tumbling. So he taught me tumbling. And his father was already a famous martial art man. And he is such a beautiful looking man, I have to say. He's a beautiful face. And we were like brothers training together, you know. And every Sunday we share the lunch. So I thought about him. I pretty much called him up and said, Mark, you know what? You are a great martial artist and you are a great stuntman, but I really think you need to dive into movies, you know, because you never know what's going to happen in these stunt work. And instead, if you can be an actor, you probably will do a lot better. So I brought him in to be my stuntman, basically. Mm. It's a very simple job. I pretty much do everything myself. But it was basically about riding a motorbike, my ninja bike, because that was my symbol, is my ninja bike. Riding my ninja bike around, you know, that's all he has to do, actually. He got stopped in front of the cop car, and that's the whole scene. It was less than probably 10 seconds of it. And he spent the whole night doing that. And because of that, he got his union card, because in Hollywood, without a union card, it would be hard for you to do anything. Mm-hmm. But because of that job, he got into the union and boom, 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 everything just blew wide apart. He did, you know, all these wonderful movies, which I really congratulate him. But he's just one of the actors I helped out to really become what they are today. And I'm happy that they are doing well. But this young man that I would like to tell you, his name is Sen Gao. Name sounded very foreign and very strange, of course. It's Chinese. He's from China. Since he was a kid, he was already performing with the Shaolin troupe. As you know, 20 years ago, Shaolin had their show throughout Europe and into America. I'm sure they've been to UK. You probably have seen it or seen it on TV. They were very popular. And this young man, since he was like 8 or 10 years old, he was already in the troupe, being the little boy who was doing, they call it a tongzigong, means the kids have their own kung fu, and in Chinese we call it tongzigong. And then of course he went on to win twice world championship of wushu in China. And to expand his own career, he went to America, and he's not an American. He opened up his own studio, but his dream always has been to follow the footsteps of Jet Li and Jackie Chan. Mm-hmm. But you know what? I only met him about 6 months ago when I finished my script and I'm looking for actors. And I happened to find him on YouTube. Immediately, I was impressed. And just to give you his title, he has 3 titles in 3 consecutive years in America, all related to All American Karate Championship. Means in these championships, all karate goes, whether you are taekwondo, karate, or wushu, anybody can get up there and perform with your own weapon. Mm-hmm. Most of the guys either do Japanese sword, nunchuck, staff. But what makes Sen Gao so special? He's not just a wushu artist. He can operate 10 different weapons easily, just like that. Wow. And one of his specialty is, I was talking about being a dancer. We call it tour en air. Tour long air in French means you are traveling in the air, spinning twice, land on the floor with balance. Imagine a human body spinning in the air, not vertically, but horizontally. Twice, not once, means 720 degrees. That is inhuman, because that can only be done if Yu Moping is around and say, okay, I'm going to put you on a wiring.
Yeah, yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah.
Because no human can do it, but many can do 360 degrees. Mark can do it. But this young man, Sen Gao, can do 720 degrees and 10 weapons easily with his eyes closed. And that's why he won 3 times championship, which is world championship. He beat out everybody else. Because when you see him on stage operating in these weapons, it's like his chopsticks. He can just close his eyes, and whatever he does, it's magical. Mm-hmm. It's like Jelly had done it 20 years ago. Look at what Sen Gao, this young man, can do today. amazing, which I already gave you the video that you can edit it in, you know, as you like to show his incredibleness. My own podcast, which I would like to give it a plug.
Yeah,
I had my own podcast just about 2 weeks ago. It's called Kung Fu Legends by James Pax, Hard Lips Production. On YouTube, easy. Kung Fu Legends by James Pax. You'll be able to find me. And he will be my next guest on my show. It's very new. We only had 3 episodes, but I got 15 other videos on the YouTube already. I hope I can emulate you, that we can be on the YouTube, Apple, whatever, you know, that we can be appreciated and we should link up together.
Yeah, definitely.
But Seng Gao is an amazing young man that I hope I can help him to make him another Jet Li. That's what I would like to do for this young man. And along with many other aspiring actors, or I should say aspiring martial artists, I would like to help them as well. One other man that I recently met and I already started promoting him, his name is Chris Collins. His episode was just uploaded yesterday, Friday. Every Friday we upload a new episode. And I did a whole 40 minutes episode about Chris Collins. An American, but went to Hong Kong, struggled for 20 years, and now he's a wushu master. Half American, half Chinese. And a very touching story about his success in Hong Kong. Mm-hmm. But he wanted to get into Hollywood, and I'm trying to find a way to put him on the map of Hollywood. And I would definitely like him to join with me in my Shaolin movie. He can be part of the choreographer with Seng Gao together. Because I think with him and Seng Gao, you're going to see a completely new Kung Fu film that is going to remind you of the 80s, good old 80s Shaw Brothers film, you know, Wim Beau and all of that. But also there's going to be new moves that's created by these younger generations, which I hope I can create a new brand. Like I said, Shaolin Warrior 7. Hopefully it will become a classic just like Samurai 7.
It's definitely got me excited. And I'm sure you as well, Chris, listening to everything that
absolutely.
James has had to
say. I was just going to recommend somebody else, actually, somebody as well we think should be a bigger star than he actually is. I mean, you've probably heard of him, but Scott Adkins, Dave has interviewed him recently, and you know, he's an incredible martial artist, and you know, some of the things that he can do as well. And he's been in some awesome films, one with Michael J. White, Undisputed, was it, Dave? And you know, keep him in mind as well, because, and I know he does a few YouTube videos, so I'm sure he'd be willing to come and talk to you as well. That'd be awesome, wouldn't it?
Oh, yeah, it'd be incredible.
Maybe you can make a referral. I definitely would like to talk.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, would you? And I will, of course.
Maybe I can bring him onto my show.
Yeah, yeah. And I'll put links to everything that you do, James, in, you know, into the notes for this show as well, so everybody can find and follow everything that you do.
Yes,
I will do.
Like I said, I'm blessed. I made the initiation to contact you, and yet you responded. And that's what I call spreading good calm. And that's what I call... it's meant to be, you know. It was the right timing. I contacted you and you responded, and now we are joined together. And those are the energies I wanted to spread around the world.
Well, it's nice, James. It's nice that, you know, we see you initially in a movie that we love, and then later on we get contact with you. Next thing, we're swapping WhatsApp messages. Now we're through the beauty of the internet and the digital age, we're looking at each other and talking to each other and recording these shows. Fingers crossed, hopefully later in the year, we'll get to meet you in person at these events. And all being well, I think with everything that you've got planned for this year, I think it'll be a case, Chris, of us recording a show, hopefully in person with James towards the end of the year. If, you know, over here in the UK would be excellent.
Hopefully soon. Hopefully sooner than later.
It would, and it'd be great to do a follow-up, you know, when everything that you've talked about becomes a huge success, and we can, you know, we can sort of brag about it and say, well, we were there when James was talking about it in its conceptual form. And then, you know, when it's become a real thing and it's gone on to be a huge success, that'd be incredible.
Yeah, because we cover movies and everything and video games, and so it would be great, all these little pieces that you've got coming together to create this big whole with Shaolin Warriors 7. It'd be really good to carry on covering that and to hear more.
Let's
about
do
you
that.
Of course. Yeah. We shall pencil that in for later.
Definitely
in the year.
Do that. Yes.
Yeah, we will.
If this Comic Con happens, you definitely have to come and meet me. First one, I'm looking at Manchester. I know it's in April.
Yeah.
So I'm just waiting for the boss to say, James, I'm ready to help you. You know, join up and I'm going to do a 5-city tour, because that's where I suggested. Do a 5-city tour. I will sign an exclusive contract with you for 2022 in UK.
That'd be amazing. Well, yeah. I'm a big believer in, you know, if you're a good person and you do good things, then good things will come back to you, like you said about karma. So hopefully then that will happen, and that would be amazing, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm. Thank you for your encouragement and your well wishes, Chris and Dave. You are wonderful guys. I would love to keep this wonderful relationship long lasting for another 10, 20 years down the road. Hopefully by then we will all join hands and have a beer and say, my God, look what we did for the last 20 years. And we're all getting old, but you know what? We accomplished something totally out of this world.
That's something good wonderful. To look forward to, definitely, James.
Exactly. And because I feel success should not be a one person. It's not about the president. It's about the whole group that supported him. You know, and that's the way I see it.
Yeah.
So let's not be all big-headed about things. I really think people should join together. Yeah. Let's all make it a better world for everybody. You know, that kind of thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think that's a very good sentiment to end the show on, James. And thank you again for giving us your time. And we look forward to seeing everything that you've got planned for this year and beyond, and chatting with you again and hopefully meeting you in person. So thank you, James.
Thank you, Dave and Chris.
Thank you.
Pleasure.